Good morning and welcome to our monthly webcast. I'm Sameer Mehta, your moderator. This is session number 133. Today, as Dr. Sharma will explain to you in a moment, out of 133 cases over almost 12 years, this is possibly, I think, the third time that we've needed to change a case. Dr. Sharma and Dr. Kinney will explain to you the need for the change. What is the case we are going to do? I am sure you're going to find it equally educational and learn various valuable tricks. With these introductory words, let me take you to the cardiac catheterization laboratory and let us share with you what is the case for this morning. Okay. Sameen, Anu, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes. So I've already announced that very unusual situation. We've had a change in the case today.
Okay, I heard.
Go. Just 1 second, we take
okay,
the
picture. Okay, go. SSU.
Good. Want to go to another view?
Yeah, I'm going to do...
Just 1 second, we get ready. As you mentioned, that of the 133, so this, today... We have completed our 11 years.
Me first.
Starting with the 12th year now.
11 years done and proceeding with the 12th.
12th. Okay. And today the end, very important. We are so thankful to our viewers, which has audience has grown. With the, starting with the first episode of July of 2009. When we have about 500 or 550 people, and now it's average monthly around 13 plus thousand. So key is, as you mentioned, this is the third case. Despite all the storms and the snowfalls and the lockdown a few years ago for a patient and so. So this is the third patient which we need to change compared to our e-blast, because the patient which we presented in the bifurcation, multiple bifurcation of the LAD became unstable and we had to take care of him urgently. It was a very significant lesion, but we found a equally interesting lesion now, which Dr. Keeney is going to show in this particular case, who had a multiple PCIs. We're going to come in 1 second. If they can start with the slides.
Yes, so Sameen, you were mentioning as to the reason why we needed to change this case.
Yeah, this patient, patient became unstable, and then we felt, let's do another educational and teaching case. And we have this patient, who actually, story on this patient started, of course, in the PCI many years, but last year he presented in August of 2019, after positive stress test at 3-vessel disease, including DS of the ISR CTO, RCA. That patient, he had a cipher long time ago, and has an ISR as well as ISR of the LPL, new lesion also in the other circumflex branches. And that time CABG was recommended because of the overall the syntax score was 33, but patient declined. Now, one of the is the decline by the surgical after the heart team discussion because of the substance abuse and non-compliance. The patient was placed on medical therapy. As you can see, diabetic, well-controlled at that time. And then since then, he has been very vigilant and have improved medication compliance, and then start having angina a few weeks ago. At that time, was brought in and had an intervention of the LAD diagonal on May 26th. And of course, because of progression of the LAD diagonal disease with a rota stent. And now today is the for intervention of the CTO RCA, which Dr. Keeney is going to show that what it is now at present. We're using some imaging technique, knowing that it's a single layer of stent, which was done in 2007. Cipher is two cipher stents in the RCA, 3.5.
So if you see the LV gram, EF is well preserved. EDP was just about 12, so we're going hydration.
Go to the fluoro again. Yeah.
All right, this image is absolutely perfect.
Yeah.
So EF is good.
Yeah. And this is the left system where we did LAD diagonal bifurcation with the DK crush. Circ is okay. Circ has good. Some disease also, yeah. Which we did not, will show you. And this is where RCA looks like has recanalized by itself now. It's totally occluded in the mid after that large RV branch.
Sameen, this was not in 2007, this was done here or at another?
Yeah, we did it here. Two cipher stents, 3-0 distally, 3.5 proximally and post-dilated. Yeah, 23 and 13, and they were post-dilated with a 3.5. And he had no event until the recently when he presented last year in 2019. So 12 years, he had fine a symptom-free or I would say minimally symptomatic on medical therapy, and then he presented. That's the time he had an angiogram, he has RCA total, and then additional disease on the left side with LAD progression, diabetic three vessel, clearly the benefit from the Freedom trial and was recommended, but there were many other social issues in this particular case. So nothing was done until May. He, of course, during this time, he has been more compliant with medications and the LAD progressed further, LAD diagonal, which Dr. Keeney did the intervention, and now for the RCA now. So it's a single layer of stent, and all the procedures on this patient have been done at Sinai. So before 2007, patient had an intervention in 2004, 2003. So three before that. Fourth one was done just in May, because angiogram in August was just angiogram, no PCI done. So today will be his fifth episode of percutaneous coronary intervention. So you can see little characteristics point of view again, that the long segment of ISR throughout and additional disease proximally.
Got it.
Yeah. Additional, moderate disease. It is about 50-60 proximally, but ISR, now it's recanalized. But the entire mid RCA, distal RCA up to the PDA, I think at the crux, it's all calcium, it's not stent.
There's no stent there. Yes. Yeah. So it's a very calcified.
Totally unrelated question to the procedure, but I think in the middle of what the world is confronting, this question is extremely valuable. It is coming to us. I'm not able to pick up the name of the person. Dr. Tilak Lal, actually from India. Are all patients tested for COVID prior to procedures?
100%, yes. And in the past, used to be 72 hours, and that has been increased to now 5 days. So every patient within 5 days has to be tested before they get onto the table.
Antigen, swab.
Yeah, antigen only now. Question is, if you need to do, even with patients who are positive, we have one dedicated room, our room one, where there is extra precautions are taken, separate staff remains inside. Nobody comes out when the procedure is done. Takes another 1 hour to clean the room and terminal kind of, we call terminal disinfection, and wait about an hour so that any virus which is on the in the air, it also will not survive. So that special precautions are taken for those COVID positive or PUI patients. That is urgent situation. Otherwise, this kind of patient will have a COVID testing first, and negative, then they make to the room. We also have allowed now, knowing that the test takes usually between 6 to 8 hours, but we actually have our some slots with the hospital that may be done within 2 to 4 hours in some cases. So we do bring many patients early morning, like 7 o'clock and so, and do the testing, and then they get the procedure after the test results are available by noontime or early afternoon. So many times you want to avoid this multiple the visit of the patients, and this is what we do. Now, as you can see here, Dr. Keeney, you mentioned now what you did, the rotavirus.
And the CTO became a straightforward, easy case now, huh?
That's what I said. Anu,
what is the wire you use?
I had a fine cross and a fielder.
Fine cross fielder.
Yeah.
Fielder XT.
Take the other wire out now, right?
No, regular fielder.
Regular fielder,
yeah.
Excellent. And we saw you cross that. Nothing.
Yeah, hold it.
Nothing unusual there. Yeah.
So actually, you know what happened is, while the vessel was completely occluded, but anytime we have seen, when it is not a real rock of calcium, particularly in this case it was ISR.
No, what size?
Once you start, 1.5. 1.5 and maybe 2 seconds. Yeah. So key is that by giving this antiplatelet therapy, it's not uncommon when they come back, you start seeing a little channel like in this particular case. Right. So it is basically nothing was touched to the right coronary, but I can show you the picture of the right. What it was there before was completely occluded. There was no antegrade, even distal flow, which we, the video which we have been sent.
So the question, there is another question which has come for you, thanking all the viewers for asking so many relevant questions, that have you ever needed to break your rule of having three layers of stent prior to using radiation again?
No, two layers.
Never.
Yeah, a lot of people. Yeah, you are right. So there are, you know, the algorithm which I'm going to show, which came from Dr. Ronald Waxman, published in Circulation Intervention last year. They did mention that some cases of tremendous intimal hyperplasia, diffuse, it's truly intimal hyperplasia, or maybe neoatherosclerosis, but more important, large, extensive intimal hyperplasia, even after one layer of stent, they do a brachytherapy. But at Sinai, we have made a rule, we never do brachytherapy until it's a two layers. Because also the data I will show that there is no true head-to-head comparison of the brachytherapy versus DES in this situation at the first episode, because most of the data are later.
Three,
because first episode, in my opinion, is still the DES will do better compared to brachytherapy or drug-coated balloon. So both of them. So that
excellent.
Is one of the reasons.
And, yeah. Would you interrogate all these with IVUS prior to?
Yeah, this actually is a class one indication coming up now in Europe, particularly that patients with a left main disease, patients with a early DES, ISR, they mentioned that those cases should get class one imaging indication, whether you do OCT and IVUS, they left it to the operator, and then so that it comes in the decision making, because many of the algorithms which are coming now for treatment of ISR, all of them are DES now, incorporate imaging in terms of what to do.
So are we planning to do that today?
That's it.
Case?
So we'll do after the...
We plan to do OCT. So we got to do rota and have some kind of a lumen in the RCA. So I just, you did ask me what was the technique to cross. So if let me show you something here. In the RCA, you see there, I think one of the challenge, whenever you have a so-called CTO, subtotal vessel, whatever it is, that if you have a large side branch, then, you know, the proximal cap, if it is very close to the side branch, usually the wire goes in. So you might have seen my fielder was just going into the RV branch. So what I did was, if you're a fine cross, bring all the way to the proximal cap, and at that time, you'll be able to navigate or get into where the CTO is or the proximal cap, and then you saw we were able to get into the
well. I think before that, Anu, you did another such a simple thing to use a guide with greater support. I think AL1 made your task so much easier. What are the plans? You plan to do a rotational ablation, and if that's the reason, why did you decide for that?
Yeah, so the algorithm, I don't know, Dr. Sharma will show you the algorithm. Here, so with the fine cross did cross the lesion after we crossed it with the fielder. Then we changed rota wire. So once the fine cross has crossed, which we have taught and we have you know, mentioned that in a various of our published papers, in the Calcificate app, all the things what we are saying, if your fine cross or over the wire balloon or over the wire catheter crosses the lesion, you can exchange in that situation. You're doing, if you're planning to do rota, you can go with 1.5. For whatever reason, the bird did not, sorry, the catheter did not cross, then what you can do is bring the catheter as close to the proximal cap or to the lesion, and you can still try to advance the rota wire. If it goes into a distal vessel, in that situation, you downgrade the bird to 1.25. So here we are going to start with 1.5. We have a 7-French sheath. And let's see what kind of lumen we will get. Since it's cipher and it's really old, we have seen a lot of intimal hyperplasia that can happen when the instant restenosis is there. So what we will do, we are ready to even do a two-over. Once that is done, then we will do the imaging.
OCT.
So essentially, imaging is going to tell us the cause of this ISR. Whether it's intimal hyperplasia, neoatherosclerosis, underexpanded stent. This is the key. But here, angiographically, I think we have shown you before, angiographically, it does not look like it's an underexpanded stent. We know procedure we have done here before. After placing the stent, where it was post-dilated, and the stent looks well opposed to the vessel wall even now.
Now, in this particular case, I'll be a little more concerned that it's not just a neoatherosclerosis, I mean, not an intimal hyperplasia. Because now we are talking about 10, 12 years later, right. And it was a DES. And we know that some of the mechanism of the DES-ISR is not intimal hyperplasia. It's a neoatherosclerosis. And how would you know it? That by doing that, you are able to see endothelium. By the OCT will be, you have classical, your three layer, and even the neoatherosclerosis can become very calcific. So one of the algorithm will be that if you have neoatherosclerosis, calcific lesion, maybe those cases should get ablative therapy before going to the re-stenting approach with the after one DS.
So, mean yeah. In the selection,
you should
in
have this, it all the time, calcificate app.
Yeah. In the okay, now let's show the, yeah, let's show the last, can we just show the previous RCA picture? Yeah, play it, please. So this is the one you see here. It was completely occluded.
And how long ago was this? Yeah.
This was a few months ago. So after the antiplatelet therapy, it has
and
come
then
out.
He got LAD PCI. Yeah. Then he got, now he's been on aspirin therapy. Plavix. And he comes back, we see some recanalization or a better vessel visualization. So we're going to do with Rotapro, same.
Okay, we are ready now. And you know,
Sameen,
there's
one specific question, I think, before we move on to rotational ablation.
Yeah.
For the wire escalation strategy for a instant CTO versus a de novo, would your approach be different?
Yes. So here you see I tried Fielder and the same thing, the first wire, whether you're using a regular Fielder XT is up to the operator. You know, we always say everybody likes a certain kind of wire or whatever they're comfortable with, what they've used to. The second wire, which we tell you, either you're going to Miracle or Gaia, here, since you know it's an instant restenosis and you think it is really hard, nothing is going through, you can go to, you know, skip the second and go directly to Miracle. Confianza.
So it means escalation is faster. In the ISR CTOs compared to non in the native CTOs. Okay, now we are ready with the 1.5 bar.
Okay, yeah. So one other thing is that suppose the rotavir, we were not able to cross with the rotavir and you already have crossed. Suppose we have confianza, we crossed, we went distal and now we cannot get the fine cross across and we cannot change to rotavir. We already have a laser sitting here next to me.
Can they point out to the laser machine?
Yeah, because that's one thing I thought that if we are not able to get the rotor through, then we should have the laser ready for the ISR.
Yeah.
That is also we have done. You can just make a small channel with a laser and then switch back to rotor with the bigger bar. Yeah, we are ready for the laser.
Elka. Right there, laser.
Elka machine, live sitting there.
0.9 millimeter catheter. It's come both 0.9 and 1.4. We use 0.9. And then you increase the fluence energy, 40-40, 60-60, 80-80, and so. Okay, we are ready.
And the same thing, you got to get the machine ready. When you're doing a machine ready, you can go and cross another CTO in another room.
it takes about 5-10 minutes. Yeah. That's the only... Okay.
We are done. Start. Okay, going in.
Good.
Adjusted the... Yeah. Okay, we will be going in now.
Check the seat.
I did.
Okay, good. Okay, go.
You want to go low, Mag?
There are actually, we had both 3 and 3.5 balloons. But yeah. Soon they are changing the Rotapro Advancer. Not definitely the console, but...
Don't need the left side.
Yeah. We probably don't need the left side, but maybe after one.
Okay.
Make sure that we have gone to the right distal vessel, because this is the case where has developed calcium both proximally and distally. Good. Same three steps.
So move the knob backward, forward, Y connector, and then do the dyna.
What are you saying? Go and ask that guy. You, him. Yeah.
Go ask him.
What are you saying? Yeah, go. No, what is saying this guy?
That's where the support of the guiding catheter is coming through.
Yeah.
And with the left hand, you see I advance the guide.
Okay. The AL 0.75 is the best guide from the femoral approach. The radial also, but radial Akari and others do work. Good. That's good. Keep going. But take your time and give few seconds gap. Monitor the blood pressure that doesn't go systolic less than 100. The same principle applies every time. This patient has a near normal ear.
Also, you know, the pecking motion is equally important in instant restenosis. Many times, if it's just intimal hyperplasia compared to calcific lesion where you can have some resistance and, you know, the burr, you can see the drop in RPM. When it's instant restenosis, it is intimal hyperplasia, which is like a glistening tissue, which is very soft. You will not hear the drop in RPM. Instead, the burr will just go forward. Okay, the burr getting stuck is very common in instant restenosis. So you still have to be very careful and cautious as you are advancing the burr.
They should show the hemodynamics also.
I'm outside the stent.
Which is okay. Yes. We have to take care of that distal calcific lesion.
So within the stent is important, and when you are at the exit also it's very important that you are very slow and you should not have a jump. If you jump, that's when you could likely have a dissection when you're exiting the stent and going to the normal segment again.
Patient is tolerating extremely well. No issues there.
Yep.
Okay, now I think this is an important point we can show. Now I'm reaching. I met the 9 centimeter, you see here. So I don't have any more space to advance the burr. So this is what I think we can show, how we can get the, all you do is go back, stop here, somewhere in the middle, right?
And you can go now forward Dynaglide. So what I'm going to do, instead of coming out, I'll be advancing the wire. I mean, pulling the wire and go forward. Go.
No. So what you have to do is you have to break release. Yep. When you break release, what you're going to do is allow this wire to be mobile. Okay. So you break release, and then what I'm going to do is just.
Let's see. Go a little lower, Max, so everybody can see things. Yeah. Good. Go.
I'm advancing the burr.
See that?
He break release.
Good.
He has a break release and just was holding the wire.
So means the totally reverse action, which you do when you break it, take it out, you go forward. Good. So now I'll take care of the distal RCA. Yeah.
And that should be distal enough.
Yeah. Enough. Yeah. Good. Okay. Come back in the
now
guide.
Coming out.
Picture. Yeah, we'd come out completely. Yeah.
Want to take a picture? No, later.
Out of.
We take a picture and we decide whether we need a bigger burr. Or we can...
Or here, do you want to do OCT at this point or a little later?
No, I'm a little later.
Okay.
We need more space.
Because the other point is that in the total occlusion, OCT may not go.
3 loops. Okay. Underneath here. We just had a new batch of fellows with rigorous training this month.
Okay, let's see the picture. Now we do routinely that question always ask pacemaker. Go. That we do routinely the R pacemaker in the right coronary intervention, the rotablation particularly, not necessarily orbital. And this case actually you can see large vessel. We have 7 French guide. It's a subtotal... RPL or kind of AV continuation, which we'll take care of later. But I think the proximal area of the ISR, diffuse, thick, bulky ISR, I think we should do hemodynamically good, use a 2 over.
Yeah, but so not the distal RCA.
No, mid RCA. The stent only, yeah.
Then OCT is ready after that.
One of the questions coming to my mind is, would you be putting in additional stents distally?
Yes, definitely, because there was we saw it by the collateral.
Significant disease.
Yeah. By collateral, we saw that disease. You can see here distal. I'll put it 1 second here. See this now? That calcific area. See the bifurcation.
Got it. Yep.
The PDA is good. The moderate disease, but distal RCA has a calcific 95% lesion.
So you'll probably put additional stents till the site of the bifurcation.
Yeah. So this is reasonable to put a second layer of stent in this particular case. because of the ISR of the first generation. I mean, not first generation, sorry. Our earlier earlier DES. DES cipher, but what size this one is? 3520 also? Okay. Yeah, because of cipher, our first generation DES, because yeah. That also has been compared, that first versus second generation DES, the what is your best treatment, is still with the first generation, the trials, the RIPS and so showed that your next treatment better is another DES using most of the data we have with the Zients and so everolimus-eluting stent. So that is the right approach in patient with the first generation DES. And then you have to outline in this particular case, you have to do it entire segment. So right from distal to proximal, this patient probably will get 3 stents.
Got it. Sameen, how do you think this lesion would have responded to orbital?
Yeah, actually, you know, orbital, we have started the paper, we did our data of the orbital atherectomy. So would have done fine. Only problem is it's such a large orbital would have given just a lumen maximum of 1.5 with the 80,000 RPM and a lumen of 1.8 if you go to 120. But in this particular case, I think we thought that there is a large bulky intimal hyperplasia or neoatherosclerosis. Hopefully we'll know by the OCT. And because of that, we need to go to 2 over. And that has been one of the reason in our algorithm that selection of OA versus RA, when you're a large vessel, you think you need a 2 over plus, the RA will be preferred. Ready?
Okay, go. Speed. Okay, good. Nice.
Okay, we go ready with the 2 over now.
Only the mid RCA.
Yeah, proximal to mid RCA.
Yeah. I'm going to take out the left system, okay?
Yeah, we don't need left system, yes.
Good.
When she says,
we can even take out completely out of the body, no? With a wire, leave it there.
Okay. Then you have to connect to pressure.
Same push and pull. Always will be a little trouble when you are ready to come out. And anytime okay. We always teach also your difficulty getting your burr into the vessel,
we'll
just
do
go on the Dynaglide. But here is okay.
No, it's still not going.
Okay,
you see this? The guide is trying to come out. Okay, now it's okay.
As long as you align it, yeah. And we are doing our all three things. Add the advancer knob, Y connector, and then your Dynaglide. Now we are ready.
Yes. Real difference will be made with the larger burr.
Yeah.
You want to go LAO? I don't like this. Straight.
So again, 20 second runs. Everybody should get that North American experience of rotational atherectomy published in Circulation Intervention.
Even the app has it.
And app has it.
Calcificate. You got to... Every time show the app.
Huh?
Every time you have to show the app.
Calcific app? Which one?
Everything.
Show?
Calcific. For this, calcific. Every rotor we
once
do.
Once again,
to keep
patient tolerating very nicely. No issue
app.
With the.
Tell them about the calcified calcification app.
Where's the picture?
Calcific app. Ask them to bring it there. Yeah, this is where having a little time.
Yeah,
tough time.
A little.
20 seconds.
20 seconds.
As soon as Pablo tells me 20 seconds, we stop.
Sameen, would coming back a little with the wire, would that help a little?
That actually, once you're a long time, we do move the wire back and forth. That time you have to just press the brake.
49, 47, 5 seconds.
Because if they keep going on the same direction, it will cut the wire.
40, 10 seconds, 45, 48, 50 seconds, 45, 50 seconds.
Okay. Yeah.
Can you hear? You can hear the drop in RPM. You don't have Pablo tell us. We can hear it. He's tolerating well. It should not be. Look at the lumen. It's nice, 1.5 lumen. Why, right?
Yeah, but still 2-0. Giving. It's a 2-0. Mm. The question is, you can increase the speed to 170 and so. And
not with 2-0, or do we change to extra support?
No, 170. Speeds 170 will be okay. Hemodynamically, patient is tolerating good. Once
okay,
you go to 170 while we are doing it, go. You can hear the high pitch. Good. Yep.
I mean, excellent question coming to you from Dr. George Sitafidis. It appears stent fracture at the acute margin of the RCA or geographical miss.
Yeah. Good. Good. Okay, just sine it. Sine only. One second. Magnify. One sine now.
For what? Wait.
Just sine. The stent fracture. Good.
No, that's usually OCT will show us.
Yeah, I know, but just. So,
No.
This looks okay. A lot of calcium.
Yeah.
It was a continuous stent, which we know, because we had the angiogram old. But remember, some the vessel will open up during the... That when you are doing a... Yeah, see. This is a 2-0 bar now, went through the stent.
I think it's okay here. I'll stop now.
Yeah, good.
Right?
Polish and thin, yeah.
Yeah, no reason to advance the larger burr into the more distal segment.
No, I think we did a 1.5 good work already.
Yeah. So, Sameen, any comments on the observation that there may be a stent fracture at the acute margin of the RC or geographic miss?
I think there's definitely some distortion of the stent at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock position, and we will have a little better picture. By doing
with
the
OCT.
OCT, yes.
Right. Exactly the reasons
There
for,
is a few millimeter imaging. Gap between the two stents, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But that gap was not there when it was placed originally. But remember what happened?
Yeah,
vessel lengthens and with the movement many times, which is just a short overlap, becomes more troublesome. So let's take a picture and then we do the OCT or you want to do PTCA first?
I would want to do PTCA, right?
Yeah.
Because it's...
You can take the RCA, the pacemaker wire out.
Oh.
Well, looks a whole lot better.
Yeah. Okay.
I think
a little PTCA first before we do anything.
So we have a 3-0 for the distal.
Yeah.
And then we have 3-5 for the mid portion of the RCA.
Right.
Yeah.
And we'll need a fielder wire for that because otherwise the posterior lateral, particularly the AV continuation will go.
Sameen, no plan to do anything in the proximal segment?
We did a little rota there. I mean, ultimately, we'll put a stent there. Proximally was always 60-70%. So we need to take care of that. So it will require those three stents covering the RPL branch. So now we are putting a run-through wire into the RCA going into the PDA. Good. We can take the rota wire out now because we want to go bigger bar.
Anu, for a patient like this with the fairly aggressive disease progression beyond the change and the institution of more rigorous dual antiplatelet therapy, anything else which could be offered to this patient as a lifestyle modification? I mean, this cannot go on forever.
This guy was non-compliant, so when he came back last time and once we decided three-vessel disease, sent him for surgery and then there was discussion, after that he actually changed. Patient literally changed, started seeing me in the office few times. Now he's very compliant with the medication, his hemoglobin A1C is better. I think he was never taking statins before. That's the thing. And of course, even on statin, suppose he is developing new lesion, then we got to be aggressive with the right? PCSK9.
So the fear of surgery still works.
No, it was the other way around also. The surgeons were not too keen with the non-compliance, and it was both sides.
So you're changing now to which wire is that now?
This is a fielder.
Okay.
Fielder, we'd want to go into the AV because there's a subtotal blood flow there. Yeah.
Right.
Uh-oh.
Went into some other smaller branch.
Yeah. Want to go to epicrania?
Yeah. No. Okay. Now.
Same.
I think.
Same place. I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
It comes a little more.
You need a sharper curve.
Yeah.
A little more.
Yeah.
Cranial. Okay. 1 second.
Just some blue towels.
Do you need a new fielder wire? Because that's.
Or maybe even a run through because it's not holding that.
Give us another run through. Give some more medicine to him. He's moving now. Change the wire.
Samin, how much is the volume back to now?
Yeah, last month we were 81.5. This month we think we'll be about 90, but we still a few more weeks to go.
And same pickup both in all three, coronary, peripheral, and structural?
Actually, coronary is slightly down. The real pickup happened actually structurally more than even before.
Right.
But coronary is still down. Good. Change the wire.
No, leave it.
No, but he's moving his hand.
That's okay.
Connected. Yeah.
No, it'll come out. Leave it. This is connection. It'll come out. Sheath will come out.
Okay, let's go with the wire.
And complete lift from the regulatory point of view for scheduling elective cases?
Yes, except that this whole corona issue and COVID testing upset some people, but that's understandable.
Right.
So once we do the wire in the postural lateral and we'll do some dilatation, I'll go to our lecture presentation and then we'll come back when we're ready for the OCT.
Oh.
It's coming through the
side hole of the. Yeah.
Otherwise, I need fine cross and a curve that will go into that, right?
Fine cross flushed.
Yeah.
Get the fine cross ready.
The question.
Remember, you need acute curve which will not take you into the RCA.
Which may require only Gaia 2.
Not Gaia 2. Miracle. Okay, get the fine cross.
Another question is, you leave two wires, dilate the distal, and then,
I was thinking maybe you'll move on to a whisper or something.
Whisper is okay with the, particularly if you're using the additional.
Sharp curve. Curve there. Samin, you want to start with your presentation so that we make some progress on that?
Fine cross and?
We have the fine cross. Which wire do you want?
Give me the fine cross.
Yep. Which wire?
I'll make with a run through better curve and then we see. Okay.
There's a new run through back here if you need one, Dr. Sharma.
And then whisper.
Not whisper. If the next one will be miracle.
Okay.
Whisper will not get
all right.
There.
So we wait. We can keep showing. Get back to the slides, please.
Calcificate.
Can they show the calcificate slide also? And that actually goes step by step approach. Whether it's a bifurcation, non-bifurcation.
Management of instant restenosis, which will include under-expanded stent. What is happening? They're trying to get the slides.
And what we need to do is put the flora on one side.
Okay, we see it now. Yeah. We see it very nicely. Yeah.
And only the flora. No hand right now. Just show the flora on one side.
Yeah, perfect. And
so basically, this goes through various steps. As you can see, choose non-bifurcation, bifurcation, aorto-osteal lesion, non-aorto-osteal, undilatable lesion, degree of calcium, angiographically or by using the intravascular imaging, OCT and so, and the calcific arc and angle, as you can see here, with and then decision using atherectomy or subsequent deployment. So step by step, all the techniques which we do in our daily life has been shown with this calcific aid, and of course this app, and it goes through illustrative examples of the calcific angles and how to do, and in detail in these particular cases. So just to say, we can come back to our slide presentation now.
Really, truly beautiful pictures in the in the aid. Sameen, before you start your presentation, a quick follow-up. I only have the first name, James. He's following a question or a statement which I made previously. Please comment on contraindication of orbital atherectomy in in-stent restenosis.
Yeah, so
you mentioned
actually,
about the diffuse disease.
So they actually, the one is the small vessel, which have been shown anything vessel less than 2.5. 2.25 orbital, but orbital can be used. My only question is, even unexpanded stent, our experience with the orbital has not been, because in unexpanded stent, rotational atherectomy works
the miracle,
by performing three. Basically the heating the vessel, heating the stent, and orbital does not heat the stent. So as far as the contraindication, it's not a product labeling, but yes, there have been many publications of using orbital atherectomy even for ISRs. But what I would say, my only caution will be that cases where the particularly unexpanded stent, so mark unexpanded stent, besides your high pressure, if that doesn't work, there are two options, either do a laser or do a rotational atherectomy. So this particular case, as we just put where, start where we left, appropriateness, and that actually has been really touted by a lot of people, that how every case we put into our appropriate use criteria. This particular case with the intermediate and high risk findings on the non-invasive testing, dual antiplatelet therapy, non-LED makes it appropriate. So with that point, we take two, always our issues are latest issues in coronary intervention. I will be starting now the two points which we said that last time we'll change it, and we'll make one more discussion. And the second one, kind of a journal club. Pick up one article only. No, not much discussion of the concept. Just take one article and kind of a journal club. So that will be the Daedalus trial comparing DCB with DES for BMS or DES ISR. But overall, discussion points are in update in management of a stable CAD and mild left main disease. Now, in this, actually, Dr. Keeney is trying, as you can see on the side. They're using a little more stiffer wire, but also many times you can just do a PTCA first, and that will open up the ostium and wire will go, but we'll try. So let's go through our point. Very important is update in management of stable CAD and particularly mild left main disease. Remember, the left main,
you want to pre-dilate then?
All have shown is a CABG in the early time, and after that we don't have the CABG and medical therapy was stopped. Because significant left main did worse on medical therapy. And so now we have many trials of the CABG and PCI. But more importantly, because of that concept, knowing the ischemia was the trial of medical therapy versus a revascularization, patients with left main disease more than 50% were excluded. So therefore, now question is, what about the left main less than 50%? And this is the part of which was presented this year. By Sripal, of the outcome of with or without intermediate left main disease, 25 to 49% or 25% on coronary CT angiography. So very important point, and of course, various outcomes, measures which are routinely done. So in this cohort of 3699 patients who did not have prior CABG, left main less than 25% was in 2737, and 25 to 49% left main was in about one third. So basically, that they try to see that yes, overall group medical therapy versus invasive strategy, but is there any impact of left main? Because this is done on the angiogram, because anything more than 50% CCTA on CT were excluded from the enrollment. And therefore, this is the description of those patients with the intermediate left main disease. So you see here the 25% left main or intermediate, which is 25 49%. The clearly that in the blue bar, patients with the intermediate left main compared to minimal left main are having the, as you can see here, that higher incidence of the age slightly higher, and more important, the risk factors. Hypertension, diabetes, much higher in those intermediate left main. Now, stress imaging, also those patients have higher severe ischemia on stress imaging compared to if you have minimal left main disease. More importantly, the patients who have intermediate left main disease has multivessel disease and more LED involvement compared to minimal left main disease. Now, very also, these patients have those who went to the cath lab in the invasive group now, they clearly have a higher syntax score as shown here. Along with, we knew that about the left main disease were there. Now, also look at the top. Even the CT angio, red, less than 50% left main, 7% had a significant left main, which was more than 50% on angio. Even when they read CT angio, red, left main, less than 25% or so, 1.4% had a significant left main, which is by definition more than 50% on angio. So just to come back to the point that the CTA once tells you something about left main, you probably, final answer will be the real invasive angiography. And of course, in this group, when they had an intermediate left main, more patients went for CABG compared to if they're minimal, then they got a PCI. So what we did, we learn that patients who have an intermediate left main in the red group have a higher primary endpoint overall, as well as cardiovascular death and MI compared to minimal left main disease. These are the various odd ratio for various primary endpoints as shown here. And more importantly also, these patients from the non-procedural MI point of view, there was significant difference in favor of particularly, as you can see here, 4.8% versus 6.8% in 4.1% with the intermediate left main to 10% spontaneous MI. So clearly, that spontaneous MI or non-procedural MI was much higher in the conservative group based on the left main subsequent assignment, as you can see here. Then, of course, quality of life also, same thing, that patients who are intermediate left main were more symptomatic, and they also derive the benefit. You see on the red, higher is our SAQ score, better patient feels. So the invasive strategy did better for these patients, whether they have a mild or intermediate left main disease, and this persisted for 3 years. So clearly what we learned basically is that even in the minor left main disease, patients who have stable CAD is very important and should be incorporated in the decision making, that you can leave it alone because they have a lot of trouble. Now then, second issue was, what about patients with a normal coronary arteries but still have ischemia? Non-obstructive CAD, which is called Seau study design, that patients have ischemic symptoms, but angina assessment but coronaries were normal. And these were about 208 patients in that analysis, and basically showed that many of these patients, even with the normal coronaries, but had a positive stress test, but have typical angina in almost half of them. We show here that from the ischemia point of view, ischemia severity, the patients who have normal coronaries or coronary artery disease, many times it's similar. Actually, you can see here, a little different. Of course, the normal coronary people have a less ischemia, but quite number of patients have positive exercise echo and so. And so also is the distribution of the angina episode based on the ischemia. So what also we learned that by the medical therapy, these patients, 50% were normalized at 1 year, while about half of them either unchanged or became worse. So very to say that this disease process, even with the normal coronaries, can give trouble on the long run. And so. So what we learned basically for the normal coronary arteries, that these are likely to be female, largely similar severity of ischemia and stress echo, and more frequent angina, but better overall angina-related quality of life. And half of these patients become normal at follow-up and so. So then there is another paper, which is actually still ahead of pub, the routine revascularization versus initial medical therapy for stable CAD, systemic review and meta-analysis. And it actually talks about all the trials which are compare medical therapy versus the invasive therapy could be PCI, could be CABG, just like ischemia trial, and they have a long-term follow-up. Overall, 14 trials from the 80 trials were included because they have follow-up, and looks like the death was identical. Then, of course, we know the issue about the procedural MI. That procedural MI was higher in the invasive group, and the spontaneous MI was higher in the medical therapy group. So overall, MI incidence in most of the trial was equal, but clearly there is a the discordance. But overall, what it tells you that spontaneous MI is lower. So the slides are somehow okay. Now also the incidence of unstable angina favor revascularization, and of course we know the freedom from angina also. And so the key is basically that patient with stable ischemic heart disease, routine revascularization was not associated with improved survival, but was associated with a lower risk of non-procedural MI and unstable angina with greater freedom from angina at the expense of higher rates of procedural MI. Longer-term follow-up of trials is needed to assess whether reduction in these non-fatal spontaneous events improves long-term survival. And of course, that is what our point will be, to see what happens in the future. So, Anu, you want to just put it together, but in the overall, I put it there, ischemia and anatomy turns out to be that overall, it is the anatomy which really correlated with the bad outcome in our ischemia trial, not the type of intervention which was done. Okay, let's go back to the angiogram now, yeah.
We've been watching you do balloon dilatation of the segments and the struggles trying to get into the bifurcation site into the...
Yeah. Yeah, go back to the floor there. Again. Yeah, yeah.
Just at the before the bifurcation at the level of the crux. Now we are ready with the 3-0. We went up to 22 distally, whole vessel. Then we went to 3-5, 22 atmospheres everywhere. And this is the final picture we have. You definitely need a supercross to get into that. Yeah. I think we'll leave it. And we'll do OCT.
Yeah,
and after that, we are ready with the stents. 3038 starting from the crux before the bifurcation all the way back.
Right.
You can open the stent, but I'll do the OCT now.
Sameen, in the meantime, excellent question. A series of questions very related to this case have been submitted by Dr. Right. Giuseppe Ferrante.
Yes.
Could you consider a trial of high-pressure NC balloon and shockwave before rotablation in this case to reduce risk with rotablator and use rotablator only after failed shockwave? Would you consider using a dual loom catheter to access the PL branch now? All very good observations. I've been reading a lot about shockwave actually from India. A lot of experience.
Absolutely. Very important points. And again, knowing that we just completed the trial registry kind of, it was just cases not randomized.
Okay, go here, live.
But show the OCT also.
Show the OCT.
Yeah, show it, yeah.
Okay, so, you're there?
Yeah, shockwave definitely will come into this armamentarium. It's not available at this time. Yeah.
Okay.
And rotablation, will be only for unexpanded stent. If the shockwave cannot open it. So combining two of them will be reasonable, particularly one burr and then shockwave. That will be, I would say, once available, will be the good approach. Fully agree.
What about Dr. Ferrante's observation about using a dual lumen catheter to access the postrolateral branch right here? Another good observation.
But to see the angulation, you will definitely need a supercross.
So
dual lumen catheter will only be okay if you want to do what we call, you want to do double wire. You want to do buddy wire.
Yeah.
And you're not able to get to the distal vessel because of a lot of dissection, that's the best time you can use twin pass or this double lumen catheter to get to the distal vessel.
Yeah, this particular case, I would say, because it will be difficult because I can tell you double lumen, my experience has been it's very good. You want to do proximally with the left main LED diagonals and so. But once you go to this angulated vessel, double lumen is not going to succeed because it's a very angulated. You need an angulated catheter, whether you use a supercross or a... venture. Yeah. Okay. What we are doing now?
So now we are going to show from distal. Kiski and Yulia both are here. Yeah. Start talking. So this is distal now. So you see the white arrow? That is where the OC, yeah, good. So now start coming. This is all no stent, right? It's all calcium and a lot of calcium. See, showing the arc of calcium. Mm-hmm. Good. Keep coming back.
You can get a
get into
also.
The lumen. Right there. Okay. We have done balloon, but looks needs more balloon, but that's okay.
But is there a calcium at that level? That is the whole question, that even within the stent, is there a calcium within the stent?
We don't see that. Keep coming. Now we are within the ISR. Calcium is outside the stent.
Right. Big time.
Right? Inside?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, he's saying at 3-4 o'clock, the calcium is protruding inside the stent. Keep coming. Yeah. You want the mic?
But here looks good.
Not
good.
Much, yeah.
Some calcium?
Yeah.
And Sameen, so, even the distal site where you mentioned the calcification, we went there with the 1.5 bar,
yes,
no?
Yes, we went with 1.5 bar. Then with the 3.0, we went to 22 atmospheres. Maybe 2 millimeters. That's not done. But I will start. Oh, this is the proximal, right?
Proximal dissection
now. Yes.
So question here comes that... Based on what you have on IVUS now, OCT, we think it's intimal hyperplasia or it's a neoatherosclerosis. That's the question. To me, it looks like a lot of endothelialization there.
No, it is an intimal hyperplasia. No, this is outside the stent.
Yeah.
You don't see stent there. Go within the stent. Yeah, but that is distal edge of the stent. We are talking inside the stent. Yeah, distal edge of the stent could be neo. Yeah, but we are talking here, this one. It's just a stent. There was a neo intimal hyperplasia, which we ablated, ballooned, and now we are ready for a second layer of stent.
Yeah. So no other question, if you magnify that area where there is obstruction within the stent, and you try to see whether there is endothelium. Right? I mean, that's where, how would you otherwise differentiate that there is a three layer, which is endothelium and the intima media and adventitia. So that is how you differentiate neoatherosclerosis from intimal hyperplasia.
Also, you need to see some lipid.
Yep, that's right. Okay. So it seems to be there's some combination, but lot of intimal hyperplasia, but then intimal hyperplasia usually do not get calcified. So usually it is the neoatherosclerosis part that get calcified. Remember, intimal hyperplasia don't get calcified.
Yeah, we never said calcium. Calcium is outside the stent.
Except in that very small 4 o'clock segment.
Mm. Okay.
Good. Okay, so now let's go and do our work.
Either way, treatment is stent.
Yes.
Anu, would you abandon efforts to access the posterolateral or try here?
100% abandon.
Right now, abandon. Okay.
Also, I guess one day we have to start talking about a radiation for interventionalists, whether it is radiation to the patient, interventionalist, because JCO, New York State has several new recommendations. One of the lecturers. We are waiting. So if we got to get into posterolateral, definitely I'll have to you start using a super cross. And you see that proximal dissection and distal vessel also, there is disruption. I think it's right now stabilize the vessel that we have opened with the stents first.
Do you want to keep this one?
Okay. This is the PROMIS what? Elite?
Yeah.
Okay. PROMIS
so
Elite.
The goal is not to stent across. Okay.
This is
right?
Connected.
Okay. Let's see.
Good. Some die. Okay. Forget that. I'm pulling good. Back.
Okay.
And then this is what we call ready.
Picture first.
Inject. Okay. I'm good. Going to go in a little bit.
Yeah.
Little bit assess. Some die.
Good. Die again.
Okay. Good. Go up.
Okay, proximal 3.5?
Yeah, 3.5, 38. It's okay.
This is the PROMIS Elite.
Can I go LAO now rather than this? It's more radiation.
16 atmosphere. Pull back a few millimeter. Good. Here you can go a little higher. 24, open the funnel.
I did that one down. And after this, we'll auto post it.
Yeah. What strength you want? Long.
Yeah, 3538. And this is other question that if suppose we thought the strength had not really expanded with high pressure balloon, we could have used a cutting balloon again. Despite, you know, rotational atherectomy with 1.5, 2.0.
And the same thing which will be, will come in the equation which the one of our viewers asked that question about using the shock wave. I would say the shock wave, the more benefit of the shock wave will be that do a one burr, not necessarily in this particular case, otherwise in a calcific lesion, a small burr, and then you use a shock wave balloon, because shock wave balloon, because being bulky, many calcific vessels and angulated may not go. So will be, we call now, like rota cut, rotational atherectomy and cutting balloon, we call rota tripsy.
3530.
Rotational atherectomy and IVL, lithotripsy.
What was your suggestion, Samir? You said you read a lot about this new shockwave balloon.
Shockwave for ISRs, yeah.
Yeah, very encouraging initial reports. And I was actually surprised at the number of institutions which have started using it. Quite surprised.
Yeah.
You're talking USA
in
or?
India.
No, in India. I was surprised.
No.
I mean,
that because
two,
they do
two...
not do atherectomy, right?
No, that too USA also. I think so much of it is how the companies position it.
Yep,
that's how I've always been surprised how OCT picked up in India. I mean, there is three
do
times more
OCT in India than here.
Yeah, than anywhere else. Yeah.
Ready?
So I think the
You're
same
good,
way.
Right? Yeah. Good.
Going it probably has to do with more aggressive positioning of a new device there.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, we have a mastered atherectomy. So unless we have randomized trial now,
yeah,
right? Good.
Just advance a little bit in between. Okay. Let's,
in the next couple of weeks, it will not be an app, but it will be a website that we will be releasing called as a Complicade, okay? All the management of various coronary complications. And here we have Gurpreet, our fellow. He was actually the cath research fellow last year who worked on that project. Will be... probably ready for release in 4 weeks.
I thought we have unexpanded stents. Why we did not have? Give 20 or less. Let's take a picture. Yeah.
And expanded stent where?
Stent in the complications.
Go. We have.
Oh, because that's not a complication that way?
Yeah, no, no.
Okay. Need a lot of vasodilators.
Yeah.
And then post dilate.
Do we post? Yeah. See that RV branch a little bit.
And the distal one you have to dilate.
Which one?
Horizontal, we have to dilate with a bigger one.
No. Once you go there, dilation, then we will have to put stents, right?
No. I'm talking about at this area, 6, 8 o'clock, 7:30. See that?
Oh, you mean
horizontal? Yeah. No, not distally. It's the 3520. Okay. With that note, I think we can finish our part two.
What part two? We post dilate and give vasodilators, SS, okay?
Okay, we can go back to the slides. Now, second is the trial basically compared, took all the randomized trials, comparing drug-coated balloon versus drug-eluting stent implantation for patient with coronary stent restenosis. So this is all the randomized trials which have been published in this field and basically found
22.
That when you have ISR 35? Of the BMS versus 35. DES, on long term, DSISR does worse than the BMSISR. You see the event rate 9.7 versus 17, no matter what treatment you have given. So one statement that when you follow patient with a BMSISR versus DES, once DSISR overall number is less, once you treat it, they have a bad, definitely bad outcome. Now, second, if you rule of the role of drug-coated balloon or drug-eluting stent, as you can see here, that in the BMS, which is on the left side, your drug-coated stent does much better compared to drug-coated balloon. While if there is an ISR of the DES, that difference is not there. So this actually puts it together, and I want to go through one by one. One is, this patients of BMS ISR, you compare drug-coated balloon versus drug-eluting, and these are the about 350-plus cases in both. And you can see here, there is not much difference in terms of overall the drug-coated balloon, TLR, MACE, death, and of course the TVR, 10.9 versus 13.7. Now then, for the DES-ISR, clearly that your DES has a lower event rate compared to drug-coated balloon. Now, this has put it together here in a very complex the slide of the central figure, which in the JACC publication takes into all these individual aspects. So basically showed that drug coats at 3-year follow-up, drug-coated balloon angioplasty and repeat stenting with DES are similarly effective and safe in the treatment of BMS-ISR, whereas a drug-coated balloon angioplasty is significantly less effective then repeat DES implantation, the treatment of DES-ISR. So very important. BMS, they work equal, but definitely in the DES-ISR is that you need a repeat DES implantation and associated with a non-significant reduction in the primary composite safety endpoint. We saw a little signal in the DES for the DES-ISR, there was little safety signal, slightly higher mortality and so. The overall DES-ISR is associated with higher rates of treatment failure and similar safety compared to BMS-ISR. So this actually the one I was mentioning from Dr. Waxman with the modified we had done. And this actually goes through five different varieties. Type 1 mechanical, 2 biological of the mechanism of ISR after angiogram and IVUS. Then 3 is mixed, then CTO, and the type 5 is 2 layer of DES-ISR. So this is where we have put it together. This is the nice algorithm to see. And exactly that is what we followed in this particular case today. And just to complete our 2 points, the recent data of the mild to moderate left main disease in stable CAD have shown higher adverse cardiac events at 3 to 4 years follow-up in ischemia trial. Therefore, we need to incorporate even my left main lesion in our clinical decision making, as many of these patients will benefit from CABG or appropriate left main stenting. Meta-analysis of randomized clinical trial comparing invasive versus initial medical stabilization have shown lower spontaneous MI, lower unstable angina, freedom from angina, but no effect on survival or overall MI or stroke. And of course, patient with normal coronaries is an important subset and get better on medical therapy. The meta-analysis of numerous randomized clinical trials comparing drug-coated balloon versus DES for the treatment of ISR have shown superior benefit of DES compared to DCB in BMS-ISR, while similar benefit of DES-ISR. There is a trend towards safety signal in favor of drug-coated balloon in DES-ISR management and should be the first-line treatment before re-DES and then IVBT for multilayer DES-ISR. So just to say, following are the true statement regarding less than 50% left main disease in the ischemia trial, except similar MACE rate between 2, similar death rates between 2, similar overall MI rates after between 2, higher spontaneous MI after invasive versus medical therapy group, and higher periprocedural MI after invasive. Clearly, the answer is D. There is not a higher spontaneous MI. There is lower, significantly lower spontaneous MI after invasive treatment. Then, following is the true statement regarding benefit of invasive strategy over medical therapy in the meta-analysis of randomized trial for stable CAD. Similar all-cause mortality, similar stroke rate, similar incidence of unstable angina, better freedom from angina in symptomatic patient, and similar overall MACE rates at 4 to 5 years. So this is basically where the invasive strategy worked. And clearly we know that incidence of unstable angina was lower in the invasive strategy group. And then the treatment about long-term benefit of re-DES versus drug-coated balloon in the treatment of ISR. of the significantly lower mortality, significantly lower TLR and TVR, significantly lower ISR in DES-ISR after re-DES, significantly lower lesion thrombosis after re-DES, and lastly, long-term outcome are similar between BMS and DES-ISR. And clearly, answer is B, lower lesion TLR and TVR with the re-DES. With that note, we'll stop here.
Sameen, going back, actually the question is both to you and Dr. Kinney. She's about to actually scrub out, I see. Excellent result in the proximal instant segment, even in the segment after that. Would there have been any purpose to putting in, let's say, a long 2-0 balloon in the very distal PDA just to augment the flow there? Would you have considered
Let's Dr. Kinney. I would definitely will do it. I always call it a makeup.
Because really, it's such a nice vessel, but really it's still a very inadequate distal runoff considering we were not able to access the postrolateral.
Would you do a little balloon dilatation of the distal vessel, the PDA?
Yeah, probably not. My guide is out. But I would want to do another OCT to see how the second layer
the downside is the balloon will dissect, and now you've created a situation requiring multiple long, small stents. But
lower balloon dilatation will be okay. I mean,
right. Yeah. I thought. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Anu, so many issues I think we addressed through this case, which turned out to be extremely educational despite not being a planned case. Discussions regarding CTO approach, how it differentiates from a DS CTO versus a de novo. The strategies of performing ablation, the concept and the purpose of treating the distal vessel, the challenges you had in accessing. There is also one final question again from Dr. Sitafidis. Any purpose for a FFR for the distal RCA in this case?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think there is no question in this particular case right now. We have done the root ablation. There is a lot of microvascular plugging. With the increase proximal flow mediated dilatation, this vessel will pump up. Right. Now, this patient also has a disease on the left side. There is a ramus and LPL. So we are going to bring back patient in about 6 to 8 weeks, and we are going to look into it at that time of the right coronary. And if some area require a little touch up, putting a little stent or so, that we'll do it at that time. So
absolutely,
I think at this time,
acceptable strategy, completely acceptable.
Because they give more vasodilator. There's no question there. FFR will be resting positive right now.
Right.
I can predict it. It will be 0.7. No, you don't need even adenosine because there is a tremendous microvascular plugging, distal vessel, but this will pump up. And we have seen it repeatedly that once you improve the proximal vasodilatation, particularly in these patients who have a CTO, the distal vessel really plumps up when they come back for follow-up.
Got it. Absolutely.
Coming back to the point, so the question is very valid. But yes, if there is a one focal disease, one focal area would have been a trouble, then you want to decide do it or not. Yes, FFR will be a tiebreaker there. But in this particular case, there is a lot of diffuse disease. Now, once you have a lot of diffuse disease, I think doing the FFR, which we know will be abnormal, will not justify putting additional stent at this time. Okay, Anu, tell us what you are planning now.
I'm just doing the OCT post-stenting, which we should have done. I did not do it.
We have a double layer stent and now want to do the OCT again to make sure everything has been nicely expanded.
Yeah.
Right. That's what I was going to talk about. Is really you're looking at this area into the expansion and exactly how the overlap is.
But I say that this point of the distal diffuse vessel, we learned over the years. I like 25, 30 years ago, I would have been more aggressive, go after those small. Then later on, we learn, as you mentioned, that you cause balloon dilatation, dissection, another stent. Leave it. As long as your proximal flow is good and distal,
the lesion angiographically, kind of grows up. Yeah.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Angiographically, there is not a 90% lesion in the mid PDA. If that is, then you put a short stent in that area. Otherwise, let the vasodilatation do its job.
Got it.
Okay, we are ready with the OCT. Good. Okay, hold on. One testing. Testing. Ready? Okay.
Okay, maybe you want to talk about that there.
Now let me just flush this back and take the guide out. Some more nitro, good.
So I mean the new fellows have started settling in?
Yes.
Yes.
So even the fellow attendings, everybody starts settling in now.
Challenging time for them, how they've needed to adjust to the circumstances.
So you can see, so if you see the whole, this is
this is the new stent and the proximal portion.
So if the stent, there was malapposition, you will see some red struts here. You see just few spots, which means the stent is well opposed. This is just the first overall picture you get by looking at this OCT. And now you can go segment to segment.
Yeah, so overall, the first picture, you can hear because...
much better now.
Yeah. Now, when you first look at it, you see that you don't see any red dots. Right. 1, 2, 3, and maybe a red dot here, which means the stent is well expanded. So if you are in a quick rush, just look at it, no red dots. That means a full, better expansion, full expanded stent. And now you can go segment by segment analysis. So you see here, well opposed everywhere. So I'm just going to scan the entire vessel right now quickly. Hold it here. I don't see anything that is well opposed is very good. Yeah. And you don't see the proximal dissection is fully covered. We had seen a big flap. You see a little bit prolapse, but that is still within the acceptable range. Yeah. I think it's a good post-OCT.
Excellent. Yeah. All right. So we are done with that now.
So when this patient comes back, I will do the picture of the RCA and show it, how the distal vessel plumped up.
I think that's completely acceptable. Anu and Sameen, thank you so much. Congratulations. Another excellent case. Good luck to the new fellows who are joining. And for our viewers, keep staying safe. And we'll see you August 18.